Karlsson, Karlsson, världens bästa Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, hoj här kommer Karlsson. Karlsson, Karlsson, ingen faktiskt, ingen annan Karlsson spelar jag så bra som mig.
Karlsson, Karlsson, Karlsson scores!
Yes, welcome everybody to the second part of this April mega episode of the Keeping Carlson Fantasy Hockey Podcast, a show late in the year, but not too late to hopefully give you some advice to help you win in any leagues that are still going into the final couple weeks of the NHL season. Brian, I want to focus this part of the show on hot streaks, okay? Guys who may be available or maybe not, but players who are just scorching up the NHL and probably people you want to get on your roster if you can't, if you don't already have them. But first, obviously, hello, Brian. How's it going? How are you feeling? Have the nerves gone down since talking to these amazing players and Ryan and Harrison?
Like, I'm feeling inspired. Like, I'm feeling ready to take a run at tier one. By the way, my why I lost? I can't be certain, okay? But it might be. I could have been amongst the names competing in tier one next year, if not for a Teuvo Teravainen Sunday hat trick against the team that might actually win it all in my tier three division. I'm now just fighting to stay in tier three by winning the consolation bracket, which has been a challenge. John Reed, our short shifts producer, put up a good fight. Anyway, I'm very inspired, and I'm looking forward to learning more from Ryan Harrison and all the tier one competitors this year and in the future. It's amazing to be playing with such a crew of fantasy savants, and congrats once again to our new Cupful Ultimate Fantasy Hockey Champion, the world's best fantasy manager, Ryan Wood. Way to go.
Woo. Okay, but with that, Brian, let's get into it here. Okay, so I want to go to some hot streaks. I want to start in Florida. Okay, Sam Reinhart, we've been giving all this kudos to Matthew Tkachuk, and for good reason, for a while now. Sam Reinhart quietly on like an amazing streak right now. And if you look at the last game, Sam Reinhart put up a goal and two assists. One of them was on the power play. The other two were at even strength playing with Eric Staal and Ryan Lomberg. So Sam Reinhart doing some heavy lifting and making it happen. And not only that game, right? He has 8 points now in his last four. I think for a lot of the season, some people were a little worried that he was a bit of a bust. Only 13 points in his first 22 games to start the year. But since then, aside from a couple cold stretches, Reinhart has been really good. And, you know, an under-the-radar fantasy playoffs MVP for anyone who had him in this matchup over this past week.
Yeah, we caught on to Reinhart when he was starting to pick up steam. It was in early January when he, you know, he'd had some nice little runs before, but nothing to really knock your socks off and nothing to make up for Reinhart's cold stretch to start the year. But he went on a run from early January to basically the almost the end of November, where he had 40 points in 44 games. And in what seemed to be a reasonably sustainable way, then he went cold again. It's like, oh, was that all a dream? No, it wasn't a dream. Reinhart now with 17 points in his last 12 games. Yeah, he scored 8 times on 33 shots. So like one out of every four of Reinhart's shots are going in these days. But hey, you'll take whatever you can get. 8 goals for Reinhart in his last 12 games. It's a huge, huge help there. And multi-point games all over the place, like more multi-point games than not over his last 12 on this current hot run through March for Sam Reinhart. So I think he's reestablished his draft value for next year as being someone who is still worthwhile. You know, we weren't always sure where exactly Reinhart would slot in on the Florida depth chart, and especially with moving pieces, Tkachuk coming and Huberdeau leaving. Man, Huberdeau, I almost like forgot his name. That's how far he's been. But Reinhart played the majority of the season with Barkov, played a lot with Lundell, actually, which is kind of interesting to think about, that he was still able to do just fine while playing with Lundell and Lomberg for stretches this year. But yeah, most commonly with Barkov and Lundell. Fantastic season for Sam Reinhart. Back on his, he's still only up to a 66-point pace, even with these big stretches, because he's had a couple big cold streaks. But honestly, I see more to like than not this season, including higher shot rates than he had last season and more time on ice. That might be because of more of a penalty kill role than Reinhart has had in the past. But yeah, it's been a good year for Sam Reinhart, and I'd be happy to take him for 70 or more points next season.
Okay, well, another guy who hit 70 on Florida is Carter Verhaeghe after his 4 goals yesterday. That also brought him to 40 goals on the season. 40 goals and 30 assists in 76 games for Carter Verhaeghe. An insane season. He was actually cold for 3 games before just going off against Columbus. I guess it helps when you're going against Michael Hutchinson. Bryce, let's say you're saying you'd be happy to draft Reinhart next year for 70. Let's say Reinhart and Verhaeghe both available to you and it's your pick. You want to grab a Panther. Who'd you take of those two?
I would take Reinhart just because I think he's a little more insulated from being, you know, from being in a tough deployment situation, or at least a little more resilient if he ends up in a tough deployment situation. Although, why wouldn't Verhaeghe be playing, up in the top six with somebody who he's going to do well with, right? Like he's clearly made his case to be somebody who deserves to be on a scoring line, being relied on. He's played most of his 2 most common line mates this season were Tkachuk and Barkov. Other times he was with Bennett and Tkachuk. So I don't see why he'd be moved away from those guys, especially when he's shown that he can cash in consistently. He took 8 shots, and that's not even the highest shot total he's had in the last 2 weeks. He had 9 shots a week and a half ago. So if Carter Verhaeghe is available late, like I actually wanted to get him in all my drafts this year. I don't know why I kept missing. I think I was just like on the wrong end of a swing, but he also upped his shots hugely this year, and he held, like, he's always been an efficient shooter, about 15% through Verhaeghe's career. But this year, he almost doubled his shot counts per game. He went from being a 2-shot per game guy last year to a 3.5 shot per game guy this year. If you ask me who I'm taking Reinhart just because I think there's a better chance that he's going to be on the top power play. And if Verhaeghe ever does lose the good favor of his coach and ends up in the bottom six, I would be concerned that it's not a place he can consistently produce from. Whereas Reinhart, even like if he's centering a third line, I still have faith that he'll be decent and hold power play deployment. But Verhaeghe should not be slept on. Like this season is not just a giant coincidence for Carter Verhaeghe. I'm looking at his 5-on-5 stats. They all look perfectly reasonable. Like he scored a lot of goals on a lot of shots with a reasonable shooting percentage.
Yeah, no, Verhaeghe's good. Yeah, I think I'm with you. Also, Reinhart gets that top power play. But yeah, I could see it being pretty close between the two of them next year. By the way, this game where they scored 7 goals, got the shutout against Columbus, it is worth mentioning. Oh my gosh, Columbus. I didn't bring them up in the injuries section, but everyone is hurt. Like, let me give you the list of players that are hurt, and you might have to tell me to stop because we have to complete the show at some point. But so Laine, Werenski, of course, has been out the whole year. Remember Werenski went down, and then it was like, it's Jake Bean time? Remember Jake Bean time?
I mean, I remember Jake Bean time.
Because he's been injured. Nick Blankenberg got some power. Oh, Adam Boakvist came back. He was on the top power play. He's injured. Nick Blankenberg injured. Gavin Bayruther is someone who's not injured. He's the one who's been on the top power play lately. That's like, what is he like, not even on the team to start the year? Then as far as forwards, yeah, I mentioned Laine. Also, Jack Roslovic just got hurt. Of course, Elvis Merzlikins is hurt now. Like, this whole team has just been gutted, so not surprised. You definitely want to take teams playing Columbus, I think, next week. Actually, let me bring that up right now. They play Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday against Toronto, New Jersey, and the Rangers. So yeah, if you've got like an Austin Matthews, you're licking your lips for what he's going to do on Tuesday. Hopefully he doesn't get rested. That would be a good game actually for the Leafs to rest Matthews, not to put any bad juju in the air for the Matthews managers. But anyways, okay, back to Florida. Brian, your favorite goalie, I should mention, someone who you've been hyping forever, Alex Lyon, got in with Bobrovsky hurt. And what a week! You know, I was mentioning Reinhart maybe as like an MVP for people. Alex Lyon had a shutout against Columbus in the last game, stopping 21. Before that, he got the win over Montreal, stopping 18 of 20. And before that, a huge win over Toronto, stopping 38 of 40 in that 3-2 win. Alex Lyon just crushing it. We don't have an update yet on Bobrovsky. He just keeps on being out. But I feel like at this point, this is what Shortchev's Jeremy and Chance were talking about. I think at this point, if Bobrovsky comes back and is healthy, like they're still going to play. Like they're chasing a playoffs. Why wouldn't you just keep playing Lyon until he falters? He's their new Hamburglar, right? To try to get them into the playoffs.
Yeah, I mean, Bobrovsky, I don't know if he was playing like sort of injured, but he lost 3 in a row before hitting the shelf, and he wasn't doing well either. 808, 905, 846, 3 straight games where he gave up 4 or more goals against. And over the last month or so, Bobrovsky's just an 871 goalie, which is not like I would go with the hot hand. Like Bobrovsky has been this cold this season and doesn't necessarily snap out of it all that quickly. And then you have Alex Lyon, who, if it weren't for Vasilevskiy, I think Lyon would be having one of the most celebrated weeks in fantasy this week, and maybe even this season, stopping 77 of 81 shots he faced for a .951 save percentage, 3 wins in a row, including coming off that shutout against Columbus. Mind you, the other teams he played were Montreal. Ironically, actually, though, he did great against Toronto, not great against Montreal. That's gave up 2 goals on 20 shots, and then shut out Columbus, which is also kind of expected. So yeah, if Alex Lyon's out there, like, look, he could blow you up. And Elon, I know you were saying, like, someone I've been hyping forever, and that's sort of like a cheeky thing. He's someone I tossed off a comment once. I'd like to see what he can do. Like, he's never had a sustained look, and I don't know why I thought he deserved one. But hey, if I did think that, I'm looking right now, so I will take it.
By the way, so on Florida, like, Aaron Ekblad was super cold. We brought him up on the last show. It was like a terrible cold streak. He'd gone like 5 games without a point since we talked about him. Like, assists in 4 straight games this week. So just goes to show you, you know, when you're thinking about your guys to add for next week, if there's someone like in a good spot that takes shots, you know how, you know, Brian and I like the shots as like someone, something to at least give you a little hint that they could do better. You know, like, now's a good time where a lot of people are like feeling desperate, just dropping someone who they drafted really high because they're not producing. And they're just like, I just need to get someone who can produce for me now. And like, I understand that inclination, but you may be able to find some gems in free agency. And Ekblad is an example. And by the way, he was back on the top power play.
Yeah.
These last few games.
Yeah, so he was in a better spot. And while, you know, he has 3 points, or, well, you mentioned 4 in his last 4, but 3 since coming back onto the top power play unit. Only one of those came with the man advantage. But still, like, it's gotta feel good. It's gotta be good for him. So it's nice to see him get some deployment again. And that's reason enough. If Aaron Ekblad was dropped, as we said on the show, like, he stopped shooting power play 2. It's not really rosterable. Ekblad is once again rosterable.
Yeah, definitely. Let's go to Detroit now. Okay, David Perron had himself a week out of nowhere. I know, Brian, at one point in this season in Kakupful, you like blew all your fab when he was dropped to get Perron onto your lineup. And then I feel it was like a day or two later you were asking me if you should drop Perron.
Yeah.
You were like, why did I add him? He's terrible. Well, anyone who took a shot on him for their fantasy playoffs, very happy, right? He had that hat trick against Pittsburgh, then the next game, couple assists against Carolina. Then he scored a goal against Winnipeg. So far, pointless today versus Toronto, but like, has this guy not done enough for you? Okay, let him have a break here. David Perron, out of nowhere, 34 years old. Detroit is running some new lines, and Perron has been right there on the top line and the top power play. I know that hasn't been the case all season, but right now, if Perron is still out there for you, I don't see why he shouldn't be able to continue something similar, like at least something valuable while he's getting this deployment with Larkin. And then I guess if you can't get Perron because he's taken too many leagues, Dominik Kubalik has been the other guy on the line with Larkin lately. And Kubalik also is on a bit of a run. He has an assist today. He also had goals in a couple straight before nothing versus Winnipeg. So yeah, at this point, I wouldn't be too upset with getting a Detroit guy playing on the top line.
Perron, absolutely, top line, top power play. And one thing to like about Perron being on the top power play, where he's been for a lot of the year, by the way, without being terribly... Well, actually, he's been. I shouldn't shortchange him. He's 22 power play points in 76 games. It felt like those points weren't coming too often lately. And coming into that hat trick, he had scored 2 goals in his last... like nearly 30 games. So things were not going well for David Perron. The hat trick was finally the dam breaking. And it's good to see that he does have 2 of these 4 goals that have come in his last 3 games leading into Sunday's game. They came on the power play, and then another point came on the assist. So as we've said, like, you want Perron producing on the power play. Like, that's what makes him worthwhile. Elon, I did drop all my fab on him, then cut bait. Fortunately, I was able to pick him up. Again,
oh, nice.
Yeah, ahead of like this run of assists because he had a good schedule. I got lucky though, you know, I didn't have a whole lot of faith that he'd do so well. And Kubalik, I was looking at him and thinking, no, he's not going to keep producing. And he has. So I also have added Kubalik to my Kakupful roster this week. And it's, so long as he's on the top line, then I'm interested in Dominik Kubalik.
Yeah, why not? For as long as it lasts. By the way, I mentioned before Alex Nedeljkovic came up because Husso was injured. Nedeljkovic pulling Alex Lyon here, coming up from the minors, and not saving the season because Detroit is obviously well out of things. But another great game, by the way, today. This game isn't over against Toronto, but at this point, we're like 15 minutes left. I don't want to jinx the guy, but Nedeljkovic has stopped 33 of 34. So definitely a big reason why Detroit is winning 3-1 at this point. But it's not only this game, right? In his previous game, he led in only two in a win over Carolina. Before that, he led in four, but it was on 39 shots in a win over Pittsburgh. And before that, he led in like two goals in a loss to Philly. Like, Nedeljkovic has been good. And this is a guy who I feel like I gave up on, you know? He was actually dropped in my dynasty league. And I was like, yeah, I mean, for good reason. He's not even playing. And you can't put him in a minor's spot. But now whoever picked him up is probably thinking like, I'm brilliant genius because you just got a goalie who it'll be fun to see now what happens to Nedeljkovic. Because after all this time of thinking he's done, now next year, who knows where he'll be? Like, Detroit obviously has Husso, and Nedeljkovic, I think, has just earned himself. You know, like, Brian, you were talking before about, like, Cam Talbot and wondering if any team is going to be interested in signing him. I don't know. Is this short stretch enough of a reason to prefer getting Nedeljkovic to Cam Talbot?
Yeah, I was going there, too. I was going to ask you, if you're an NHL team, who would you rather between Nedeljkovic and Talbot? And I think I would I'd prefer Ned, just because he's younger. It's been a really rough season for him. I mentioned quality starts for Talbot. Nedeljkovic is at 37%, which is just absolutely brutal. But he hasn't had a lot of opportunities, and it's been a trying season for him. Detroit was ready to move on entirely. He was playing in the minors most of the year. 912 save percentage in 26 games with Grand Rapids, so at least he was holding his own down in the minors. And we'll see if he's earned another shot. I feel like he's earned another shot, at least as someone to compete for a backup job in camp. And if everything breaks right, like, Elon, you dropped him in your dynasty. Is he still available in your dynasty league?
No, he got taken. That's okay. Yeah. We have a max four goalies rule. And, that was another reason why I didn't jump on him.
Yeah, I could see why if I was limited to four goalies, he might not make the cut. But I think he's worked his way back into some of the, deep keeper dynasty league conversations.
Yeah, so he's a UFA. We'll see what happens next year. And then, one last thing I wanted to mention on Detroit. Just a fun thing. This is, again, like, for a future in Dynasty. A high draft pick, Marco Kasper, getting his first game today for the Red Wings. And, not too exciting so far. He's played 10 minutes of ice time, no points. He's taken a shot. So, I don't know. Nothing really to act on here. Just kind of fun to see Marco Kasper get in after, like, playing the season in Sweden and doing really, really well. And a lot of people are, like, been praising Steve Yzerman for, like, another genius pick. And, we'll see how he turns out. It'll be fun to see if he gets in next year. I am seeing, Brian, this is, like, my, like, kooky idea, which is, like, crazy and dumb. But I'm seeing that Kasper has taken 8 faceoffs and he's only won one of them. So I'm hoping, because I have him in my Dynasty League, I'm hoping that next game they put him on the wing just to, like, see, like, oh, maybe he's not ready to play center. And then going into next year, he has left wing or right wing eligibility to go along with center eligibility. So that's what I'm rooting for at the end of the season.
Love you thinking the long game for Marco Kasper, who, by some measures, like, I remember I saw a tweet earlier this week from, I think it was Byron Bader, saying, like, Marco Kasper, not a whole lot of production for him in the Swedish league this season. And Prashanth Iyer, who I hope we'll have back for 32 beats this year, was like, I wish we could find another measure other than this NHL equivalency that we come up with points. And then somebody else shared a chart, and I can't remember this hero, but just saying, like, basically Marco Kasper's value to his team, like, it was sort of like a war, like, wins above replacement stat. Even though he only had 23 points in 52 games, he made his team better. And he was 18 years old, playing in Sweden's top league, which is one of the world's top leagues. So that bodes well for Kasper, who turns 19 in about a week, and hopefully will be in full-time NHLer next year with left-wing eligibility.
that would be my hope. Okay, Brian, we still have, obviously, a bunch of hot streaks to get to, so let's take a quick break, and then we'll get to as much as we can. You are listening to Keeping Carlson. Okay, Brian, we are back. And actually, I said we're going to be talking about hot streaks, but of course, in Buffalo, this hot streak has to first be prefaced by saying that Tage Thompson has been hurt. He's been out skating and is much improved. The coach in the latest... I'm over here on gamedaytweets.com. You can filter news by player. Super handy. If you ever make a fantasy hockey podcast, I definitely recommend gamedaytweets.com, and you can just get the latest news on a player. But Granato added Thompson still out skated today. It's much improved. It's close to clearing, the coach said. of the injury. Also, Stillman back in for Bryson tonight. Okay, that last part isn't too useful. But so with Tage Thompson out, it's been Casey Mittelstadt centering the top line with Alex Tuck and Jeff Skinner. And things are going very well for Casey Mittelstadt. He had 3 assists in the game yesterday versus Philly. Before that, 2 assists versus the Rangers. Before that, 1 assist versus Montreal. So I think that means that he's going to get 4 assists in the next game to keep the pattern going. But yeah, add it all together, we've got 7 assists in the last 4 games for Casey Mittelstadt. It would be nice to see a goal there, but you can't complain with all those points. So yeah, going into next week, especially, well, I mean, only if you see the news that Tage Thompson continues to be out. You know, Buffalo, again, just a boring old Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, but I wouldn't mind a Casey Mittelstadt playing on the top line with Tuck, who, by the way, Alex Tuck, the MVP there for Ryan, or one of his, with that hat trick in the last game. On most of those goals, I'm assuming, assisted by Casey Mittelstadt, right? So he's in a really good spot and showing that he's not the total bust that he seemed like himself after a few seasons.
Yeah, I think the hope for Mittelstadt, for the biggest hopes, were that he could be someone who could like really anchor a scoring line. I think we've seen that he's not capable of that, and now we're trying to find out, okay, can Mittelstadt complement a scoring line? And so far the answer is yes, but I'm also not totally convinced that like he deserves this role. And as the rest of the Sabres mature, like, you know, you've got Peyton Krebs playing on the third line right now. I'm not sure Mittelstadt's spot in the lineup is super safe. I think he's like an average NHLer at this point, maybe somebody who does, you know, end up in a middle six and occasionally has good deployment. Elon, I appreciate your optimism, but I think the ceiling is pretty low for Mittelstadt. But right now, yes, 7 points in his last 4 games. It's not a time to talk him down. There's going to be lots of time for that down the road, according to what else I'm saying. Only 2 shots in his last 3 games. So in a Cats league, that's not going to be so helpful for you. So hopefully those assists keep coming.
Yeah, well, hey, the only thing I'll say in contrary is I thought the same thing about Barrett Hayton going into the season, and he's shown that, you know, it took him a while, but he got going. But anyways, yeah, it's obviously just a short run, and I'm just talking about for next week. If Thompson is injured, Mittelstadt also has been on the top power play, so definitely a good spot to be in. Another goalie that I want to bring up now, I guess for every team, for Reinhart, I talked about Alex Lyon, for Perron, I talked about Nedeljkovic, now for Mittelstadt, we got to talk about Devin Levy, who I believe we talked about last week, saying he's coming. Well, he came, and he conquered. He saw and he conquered, right? He played against the Rangers, his first ever NHL game, and he only let in 2 goals on 33 shots for the 3-2 win. Super exciting moment. It was an overtime win. And yeah, for this year, Buffalo has a million goalies, but I think I would love to stream in Levy for any game he's playing. He's probably still available in a lot of leagues. And like I said, so Tuesday, Florida, Thursday, Detroit, Saturday, Carolina. I mean, Florida's a little scary. Carolina hasn't been scoring too much. Yeah, give me a Levy game if I can get it.
I think so. I mean, I'm trying to compare him with the other guy, like a Cam Talbot or Nedeljkovic or Dostal. And if I prefer, like if I know all of them are starting, do I go Devin Levy? I guess so. I don't know. I also don't know that like how many starts he's guaranteed. Like,
yeah, I'm saying stream him. All I'm saying. Don't add him now. Stream him when he gets announced.
Keep an eye. Yeah, because Eric Comrie had 2 great starts before Levy got a start, and then Luukkonen faced 42 shots against Philadelphia. Maybe that's why. They took plenty of shots on DeSmith today. They ended up scoring twice, but Luukkonen stopped 39 of 42 against Philly for a really nice outing. So if Levy plays, yeah, worth a spot start. And you know what? I probably would take him over Dostal, over Talbot, maybe over Nedeljkovic.
By the way, Brian, it seems like as we talk, we change the course of events just by saying things, and the opposite happens. Like, we talked about how Josh Morrissey is super cold, just got an assist on a Pierre-Luc Dubois goal. We talked about how Nedeljkovic was doing well, just let in a goal by John Tavares. So sorry to him.
It is.
You're welcome to Morrissey.
It is Nedeljkovic, by the way.
Nedeljkovic, my mistake. Yeah. Okay, let's go with Nedeljkovic moving forward. That's a fun little... And Roslovic or Roslovic?
That's Roslovic. You know, like,
well,
it's
confusing.
It's a Slavic name, and I think some players, like, you know, whose parents immigrated at some point, keep the name and, like, keep the... Like, Travis Hamonic is Hamonic. He's not Hamonich. Yeah.
It's hard.
It's like personal preference. Yeah, especially without the accents. That would help.
Josh Morrissey just got another assist. It's 6-0 now for the Jets. The second straight game scoring 6 goals for the Jets. And this was against a tougher team in the Devils. Blackwood is now in, taking over for Vanecek.
Did Dostal get pulled? Is that what I'm seeing here too? Did we have an Anaheim Calgary game where both goalies got, like, Markstrom got pulled after giving up two goals on 9 shots in the first?
I'm not seeing that Dostal has been pulled, according to my source here.
He's just having a bad night.
Well, maybe he'll get pulled soon. Well, Gibson is out. Who's even the backup right now? Stoli the goalie still isn't there. I don't even know who's backing up on Anaheim today. Someone in the chat, let us know here. Since you're giving Brian misinformation about Dostal being pulled, at least you can help him give us some real information.
Let's see. Yahoo's showing John Gibson backing up.
Oh. Well, what do I know then? All right, let's continue on
here. And Vlado's given up a goal on 4 shots against. Maybe Markstrom comes out to start the third.
Maybe.
You'll know, dear listener, by the time you hear this.
By the way, Mackenzie Weegar has been looking good on Calgary. Since we're talking about this Calgary-Anaheim game, I wanted to bring Weegar up. No points today, but before that, you know, it's crazy because Weegar's been off the top power play. It's been like Hanifin or Rasmus Anderson getting more, but like lately, Weegar's gotten on the top power play. He's taking a ton of shots. He had 2 assists in the last game versus Vancouver. I'm seeing him get on the score sheet pretty often, plus a lot of shots, plus a lot of blocks. This is kind of the... Oh, and a lot of hits. This is kind of the stat sheet that I was expecting from Weegar at the start of the year, so... I wonder if this is going to be a situation. Remember when Pavelski, obviously a different position, but like when Pavelski went to Dallas and really stunk in his first year, but and Bobrovsky actually on Florida also in another position. You know, maybe some players just take a longer time to adjust to their new situation. But the way Weegar is looking now makes me think maybe next year he can be like a sneaky late. You know, if you're grabbing your fourth defenseman, maybe grab Mackenzie Weegar and hope that he could continue what he's been doing at the end of the season. Just an important thing to note. And like on the flip side, Rasmus Anderson has been like super cold lately, which is disappointing because he's sort of like convinced us that he's a solid top power play guy. I'm not saying he's going to get bumped from the top power play, but we're looking at no points in 5 games. He looks like he got an assist now today against Anaheim. But yeah, just wanted to bring up those 2 Calgary defensemen and the interesting, it's kind of like in Winnipeg also. It's like up is down. Like the guys who you expect to get points aren't, and the ones who you weren't expecting are starting to do stuff.
Yeah, Weegar is like the Pionk from last week, right? Where's this coming from? I'd love for Weegar to chill. I'm sorry to talk a lot about my team. He's got 4 shots halfway through the game against Anaheim tonight, and had 2 assists and 6 shots. Like if I lose in my my final matchup this week, it'll be because of him. So I'm not sorry. I'm not cheering.
We hate you, Mackenzie.
I'm not a fan, but he's been very, very valuable. Yes, it's nice that the peripherals are coming and that the points happen to be coming too.
By the way, on Anaheim, I was going to bring up Trevor Zegras as someone on a cold streak. I see he has an assist today, which is nice, but Zegras is someone who you were expecting to be like one of your star players in your fantasy playoffs. And unfortunately, this assist, you know, then a couple games ago, he had an assist versus St. Louis, but we're looking at only like those 2 points in his last 7 games. He missed a game versus Seattle earlier in the week, but yeah, Trevor Zegras totally falling off. Does that affect anything for you? Like, I guess, is he, you know, kind of like a Nick Suzuki situation, like going into next week? Now, like, I did talk about a matchup maximizer, how Anaheim has a decent schedule next week. They have 2 off-day games, which is the most of any team, if you consider Tuesday a busy day for your team. So probably you're not dropping Trevor Zegras, but what's going on with this guy? I guess everyone's hurt also, which doesn't help. Right? Troy Terry is out. Yeah. Henrique is out.
And even when they're healthy, it's not the easiest of roles for Zegras to continue, you know, being able to put up points. I think this season we've seen him hold steady from last year, which I think is a plus. Like we've seen that last year was not a fluke for Zegras. And now in his age, he's 22 years old now, but this was his age 21 season. He looks solid. He had a bigger role, bigger assignment this year, playing another minute per night. And he was able to produce at a very similar clip to last year at 5-on-5 and on the power play. And that is despite some difficult conditions in Anaheim. So I'm looking forward. Like, he was a hot ticket going into drafts this year. His second straight season now, the Zegras looks like he's going to finish off with about a 65-point pace over a full 82 games. Kills you in plus-minus, of course, minus 25 this year. But if I'm looking ahead to next year, it's nice to know that the floor for Zegras seems like a pretty safe 65, and the upside for 5 or 10 more is there, depending on what happens around him in the offseason.
Yeah, I think if anything, probably he was being, like last year, like you said, he paced for around 67. Then I think he was being drafted this year as like a 75-point guy, you know, an exciting rookie. People were like taking him as if he's going to like really take that next step forward, and he didn't. And so I think next year, he's probably going to fall in drafts compared to where he got drafted last year. But I would say, I would draft him next year where he was getting drafted last year. Like, I feel like now is your chance to get Zegras at a bit of a discount, because I don't think this is, you know, where he lands in his career. I think we're just waiting for the breakout. And I think like third season could definitely be the time when he really gives you, you know, obviously don't reach too high, but I definitely wouldn't be shocked to see him take that next step.
Yeah, I said 5 or 10 more points, and that was like strictly for next year. Like, there's upside beyond that for years following, you know, especially once Anaheim is competitive. And again, next season is just going to be his age 22 season. So, yeah, please don't get me wrong. There's lots more room for Zegras to grow beyond this year and probably even beyond next year.
All right, Brian, I still have a bunch of hot streaks. I want to do next, like, a bunch of guys that probably are, like, 0 or 1% rostered, okay? Guys a lot of people haven't heard of that are doing really well lately. And so, you know, in your deep leagues, these are the types of players you're looking to add in your finals or maybe thinking about for next year. So we'll get to them very soon. You're listening to Keeping Carlson. We are back, and Brian, here we go for the final stretch of this episode. You know, we're rolling to the end of the season, and you know, not a lot of players are getting new opportunities on their teams, getting called up from the minors. I want to start in San Jose, where it's just like a whole new roster for the Sharks, actually. And, you know, a lot of people are taking advantage. Like, just in this last game against the Coyotes, what a fun night, right? Tomas Hertl was playing on a line with Jacob Peterson, who was acquired from Dallas. And Jacob Peterson also played, by the way, on the top power play, scored a power play goal, points for his third straight game. We're up to now 4 points in 6 games for Jacob Peterson on the season since he's joined the Sharks. And like I said, line one, power play one. And then the other guy on the line was Daniil Gushin, a guy who was drafted in the third round back in 2020, played his first career game yesterday. Brian's like smirking at me, I think, as if I'm like making up names. These are real players.
No, I love it.
Gushin scored a goal in his first game, took 4 shots. It was actually a power play goal from the second power play. Gushin looking, having a better first game than Marco Kasper. I don't know. I don't know why I'm saying that. Apropos of nothing, he's a little older. He's 21. Like you said, Kasper is 18. I mean, and that's not it. Like, I could keep going. We talked about a guy named, what was his name? I even forget. He wasn't in the roster this last game. So now he's off our radar. There was another guy on San Jose that was getting points after being in the minors all season. But yeah, he had to leave to make room for Kyle Crisculo, who played his first game also of the year and also scored a goal. And also Thomas Bordalo came in, and he's like obviously the highest pedigree guy of all these people we're talking about. And Bordalo had an assist in his first game versus Vegas. No points in that game against Arizona yesterday, but he was like a second round pick for the Sharks. So we've got a ton of names here of players getting opportunities. Oh, and of course, one guy who's been around the whole season, but he needs to be mentioned in this segment, is Noah Gregor, who got a hat trick yesterday. It's not just a random hat trick out of nowhere. 7 points in his last 5 games. So Gregor has been producing. So I don't know. I've just named like a whole bunch of random Sharks that are probably all available in every fantasy league pretty much. Is there anyone here you'd like roll with more than the others going into next week?
I don't think so, Elon. Like, I want the guy playing with Carlson. You know, but aside from that, I want the guys playing with Hertl, who in the last game were Jacob Peterson and Daniil Gushin, who you've both mentioned. Gregor was playing with LeBanc and Nico Sturm, and you had Couture and Bordalo as the two other guys we haven't mentioned on the top power play. I know this isn't what we're supposed to be doing with this. Like, you asked me about all the other guys, and I brought up Carlson, and I talked about the other guys, but I just want to talk about Erik Karlsson putting up 4 assists with that roster of guys that I just mentioned. Like, Erik Karlsson is out of this world. There's one particular goal where he was like the only guy who was in the end. Like, it was Daniil Gushin on the power play from Karlsson and Jacob McDonald, scored on Ivan Prosvitov. And it's like Erik Karlsson is the only NHLer in that group, like from that whole goal, or at least the only NHLer as of this moment. Gushin is he's small, all right? He's listed at 5'8", which means it might be generous, 165, and hasn't even been like terribly offensive. This is his first full pro season, third round pick in 2020, at 36 points with the Barracuda of the AHL, which is not a bad debut at all. And then Jacob Peterson, he's 23, and he also he was, like you mentioned, he was traded to San Jose late. He's done well with the Barracuda, 6 points in 8 games after being like kind of a nobody with Texas when he was in the Dallas system. Now 4 points in five games for the Sharks. So I guess these are the guys playing for the San Jose Sharks. Elon, I think it's just as likely that the Sharks get like shut out completely as it is that any of these guys produce. So it's hard for me to really endorse any one of them over the other. I don't know. Is there someone you like from this group?
I mean, I'm so biased. I have Gushin in my dynasty league.
I could tell, actually, just the way you said his name. I knew it.
So actually, how this league worked is we like had our first draft in year one where like everyone was available. You know, it was the first draft. Then like the next year, I traded away like all my picks. I won the first season, by the way. Oh, and also, by the way, congrats to Maddie. He and I are winning this season as well. Look at us. But anyway, after that first season, we traded away all of our picks. So going to that next draft, our top pick was like a third rounder or fourth rounder. I don't even remember. And it was, we waited and waited through this whole draft. And it was the only people who were like drafted in that year of 2020. And we took Daniil Gushin as like the first ever draft pick we took out of like, you know, people that were like outside of that first year's draft. And so it's fun to see him play his first game and score a goal. It's like, I've waited a long time for this, Brian, and it happened, and he came in and scored. So I'm excited about that, and we'll see what happens with him. So yeah, if Gushin is playing on the top line, I like that, four shots. But yeah, also hard to ignore Peterson, who's also on the top line and also on the top power play, but he's not like shooting as much. But yeah, who knows? But like you say, Brian, they might get shut out, but with Erik Karlsson going, I feel like they might not get shut out because Karlsson is 96 points now. He's on his way to 100. He's going to get there.
Worldly.
Yeah, someone's going to have to get points with him.
I can't decide if it's like more amazing that he's doing it on this roster or like it's like, oh, well, of course, because he is all the offense all the time.
Yeah, he's like, great.
Like and, if he was on Boston or Toronto, like if he was on like a really high quality team, he wouldn't have as many opportunities to point.
Yeah, that might be the case.
Yeah.
Also, I think San Jose is like so interesting. I know like a friend of the show, you know, producer of, what do we call him again? A media producer, John Reed for Short Shifts. Anyways, John is a huge Sharks fan. And he's been like complaining all year about like, why wasn't Eklund on the team? Why isn't Bordalo on the team? You know, but I think maybe the plan was just none of these guys get on the team. We tank, they get Bedard or like one of these like high end guys. And then next year, all of a sudden, like maybe this rebuild could happen quick. Like there's a lot of exciting young players here if it all clicks. And so we'll see what happens. You know, they obviously lost Timo Meier, which stinks, but you know, they still have Karlsson, they still have Hurdle and a bunch of guys, and we'll see how it goes. It'll be fun. Oh, they have Couture, for whatever it's worth. Anyway, Brian, so another team that we've already like talked a lot about how they have a bunch of guys lately is Nashville, right? They've like, since Duchesne went injured, I think on the last show we talked about how like all these guys like don't look like they would have been NHLers going into the year. Like this top line of Novak, Evangelista, and Kiefer Sherwood, like you'd think like, how is this a top line on a team? But like they just keep producing to the point where it's like, I can't stop bringing them up on the show. Like, I think we just renamed the show, like, Talking Preds. And talking, like, it's like Tommy Novak just had a 1-goal, 3-assist game against St. Louis. Amazing. Luke Evangelista, you know, had a goal and 2 assists in that game. Kiefer Sherwood is, like, not on the top power play, but he's getting points. So I guess it's kind of similar to San Jose. You know, like, say you want to, like, these guys are, like, Tommy Novak's starting to get taken in a lot of leagues. But aside from him, you can get Tomasino. You can get Cody Glass, who scored a goal in the last game. Cody Glass, by the way, up to now 4 points in his last four games. Really nice to see him making something of his career. There's another Barrett Hayton or Casey Mittelstadt type, like, seemed like they were, like, totally not going to pan out at all. He was a 6th overall pick. And now Cody Glass is looking good. So I don't know. We've already talked about them like every week, but I just need to keep bringing up that these Preds are scoring.
Yeah.
And it's good for them. And like, it's exciting. They just like destroyed St. Louis yesterday, 6-1 with this roster that looks like the type of roster that you would have expected Arizona to go into the season with.
Yeah. Like it would be really hard to ask, I would say not just a casual hockey fan, but like a hockey fan to name guys on this roster. Like the only one who had any fantasy value going into the season, there's one right now is, okay, aside from Saros, but there's one, and it's Tyson Barry, and he wasn't even on the team to start the season. There is nobody in this depth chart who we would have looked to and been like, yeah, you might want him at some point. So good for them. It's funny, Elon, like the last 2 weeks for sure, maybe three now, Frozen Tools has like a popular profiles widget in the top corner, and you see it, you know, on every page you go to on Frozen Tools. Novak and Evangelista have been consistently there. Like, so everyone is still kind of like tuning in, checking them out to see if it's real. And at this point in the season, I don't think it's that important to ask, is this for real? I think it's just important to try and jump on when you see magic happening. And that you know, if you have Glass, Tomasino, Novak, or Evangelista playing on the top power play in Nashville, that's opportunity. Elon, I won't say, like, they hung six on the Blues on Tomáš Greiss. But before that, the Preds had just 8 goals in their last 5 games. But that was preceded by a 7-goal outburst that also caught our attention. So I don't think it's, like, it's safe to say that this version of the Predators is going to be consistently scoring and good for points. But the guys, like, it's coming just from a select group. You know, you've got your Novak, you've got your Barry, and Evangelista's getting Glass. You mentioned all the names already. So if you got one of those, there's a half-decent chance, but it's not a lock. Like, these Predators are missing so many guys right now that I'm not necessarily counting on them to continue to be reliable, especially their next opponents are Dallas, Vegas, and Carolina. So good luck to them. We'll see how many goals they can score.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not discounting Novak at this point. He just keeps going. But you mentioned UC Saros. We should probably mention him. Like, what a season he's having. I feel like we haven't mentioned him enough on the show. Second in the league for games played. Only Connor Hellebuck has played more. Believe it or not, third is Sorokin, tied with Vasilevsky and Ottinger. So Sorokin, someone who, like, we thought maybe would be not a tandem, but, like, you know, Varlamov. Like, no, it's like the volume guys are, yeah, Hellebuck, Saros, and then, yeah, Sorokin, Vasilevsky, Ottinger. Then Binnington would have been up there, but then he, like, got suspended and missed time and then lost those games to Hofer. But, yeah, Saros probably won't be in the Vezina conversation this year. I think he maybe should be. You know, like, it's interesting. Like, it's not something for us to really debate on this show, but, like, Ullmark is who everyone's talking about. He has a .937 save percentage, but, you know, Ullmark's down to 47 games, you know, and Saros has 59 and Hellebuck has 60. Like, I wonder how much that goes into deciding who you give the Vezina to, because also, like, you know, not to discount Ullmark, but Boston's a pretty great team. You know, they have a really strong defense, and you look at, like, Saros and Hellebuck and Sorokin, maybe even, you know, like, I don't know. I feel like I'd maybe go with the guy who's, like, playing a ton of games and doing well. Like, yeah, those are. I think my finalists would be Hellebuck, Saros, and Sorokin. I know Andy's here in the chat. He's probably going to get mad at me for not saying Ullmark, but I don't know. But Saros is amazing. I just want to bring it, like, he's really made a name for himself.
Yeah, and we also got to give it up to Saros for facing the toughest competition of the guys you mentioned, although he and Sorokin are seeing similar. If I'm ranking goalies by, like, the metric that I think is best at describing a goalie's performance this year, which is Delta Fenwick save percentage at 5-on-5, it goes Sorokin and Ullmark and Swayman all at the head of the class, followed a little bit, like, not far back, are Gustafsson, Saros, and Ilya Samsonov, which is just wild. You know, we always talk about goalies being tough to predict. I would say we would have seen Saros and Sorokin coming of those top 6 goalies this year. And then after that, it's Jonas Korpisalo. So just another wild season for, like, goalies. You know, goalies make fantasy very challenging, but they keep hockey fun. You know, it's great to see guys rise and fall and there to be so much variance. I think it makes things pretty entertaining. And that's just at 5-on-5. You know, if I adjust for all strengths, we'll see. Well, I don't know. Let's see what we see here. I wasn't planning on it. We see Ullmark at the top, then Sorokin, then Gustafsson, Swayman, Saros. So it's a very similar group at the top. Those guys are doing very well, shorthanded as well, is the Coles notes on why that is. But yeah, huge season for Saros. I think, honestly, Elon, any of those guys, you know, you look at Swayman and Gustafsson having played a good deal less than the group, but I'd say Saros, Sorokin, and Ullmark are your Vezina finalists. And I think Allmark's going to win.
We'll yeah, he'll see. Probably win.
Yeah.
Also, by the way, this is the least hot take ever. Andrei Vasilevsky is very good. He's, like, really...
He's right up there, yeah.
He's come through lately after maybe not the most exciting season, but that's, like, what Vasilevsky does, right? Like, and Tampa Bay, you know, Tampa Bay went through that cold stretch at one point, and maybe Leafs fans were thinking, oh, like, licking their lips, look, Tampa Bay is struggling. Like, now all of a sudden, Vasilevsky is, like, on fire. He's led in either 0 or 1 goal in each of his last 3 games.
You know how, like, you used to be terrified if your team was going to face, like, Brodeur or Hash in the playoffs? Like, Vasilevsky has definitely reached that status. Like, no matter how good your team is, that's not who you want to see on the other side. Like, that he could win 4 games easy out of 7.
Yeah, okay. So, Brian, I still have a few other guys I wanted to bring up here. Maybe we could do a little lightning round. Oh, some defense that are hot. Sean Durzi came back from injury for LA and went and put up 4 points in 4 games. Nothing so far today in this game versus Vancouver. On the flip side, Kopitar was ice cold, pointless for four games. But I see he has two assists today versus Vancouver. So both of my narratives are being flipped in this game. I was going to have such an interesting, good question for you about Kunders to keep this up and when is Kopitar going to heat up. But I guess, anyways, Kopitar is fine. Like, whatever. We don't need to waste people's time for you saying that Kopitar is great. But what about Sean Durzi if he's still out there? I think he's not rostered in too many leagues. And he's had like a pretty good season overall. Like, I think he's worthy of drafting in leagues next year at the very least. Like, he has a 47-point pace overall. Nice run lately. So obviously, like, LA is another one of these Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday teams, so not super actionable for next week, but just wanted to bring him up because I know that there have been times when you've been cool on Durzi, but I don't think at those times when I brought him up before, you were predicting that he'd end with a 47-point pace.
I think, yeah, I've seen like low 40s maybe is what I adjusted to, and I might not have even been there at the start of the season, to be fully transparent. We'll see. Like, he's not someone I'm going to draft next year unless there's any news that he's going to take over quarterback roles on the top power play, mostly because this season he has 16 power play points that's helped him get to a 47-point pace, which is unreasonable to expect to happen again next year if he is quarterbacking the second unit in large part, although some of those, you know, did come. There were a few games here and there where he was on the top unit through the course of the season. Maybe Doughty's a year older, so you can hope, but it seems like a little much. He's also shooting 9%. Durzi barely shoots at all. 1.5 shots per game. And he's got 2 goals on his last 4 shots. That's been part of this run. So yeah, Elon, I don't know if I'll ever totally warm up to him being far above a 40-point player until I see his deployment change, or until I see LA become, you know, like a much more offensive team where it's just like, you know, if it's like Colorado where you're on the ice, likely to see a goal scored, which means there's a good chance you can get in on it too.
Yeah, and by the way, speaking of LA, Kevin Fiala has been in and out of the lineup, so that's a guy you're gonna have to be worried about, and, you know, make sure to not leave him in your lineup on a game when he doesn't play, like today. He played yesterday, not playing today for the Kings. So watch out for Kevin Fiala next week. Make sure you don't accidentally leave it like a donut in your lineup because he's not playing. There's like Noah Dobson. I'm getting tired of him because he was like cold and I brought him up on the show. And then you said that, you know, whatever. We just got, and then after that, went hot.
I said you could drop him. Thank you for like protecting me, but I can own it.
No, but it's fine. And then he went on a 4-game point streak, and now he's cold again for 5 games. So like pointless in his last 5. So
if you dropped him, you don't have to feel so bad unless like you lost because you missed that production. But then you might have lost this week because you were holding on to him while he continued to not produce again. He's frustrating. All right, like I'm looking at his shot counts. I'm gonna go just like go backwards. Most recent to like going back in time. One shot today against Carolina. 4 shots the day before against Tampa. 1 shot against Washington. 4 shots against New Jersey. 2 shots against Buffalo. None against Columbus. 5 against Toronto. It's just hard to really understand. I can see some fluctuations in power play time that might help describe why there might be more shots than on some nights than others. But like, it's hard. It's hard to roster a guy like this. And we were it's disappointing. We were hoping for so much more. He, for all his power play time, has just 1 more power play point than Sean Durzi, and that's in like 7 more games played, and is pacing for basically the exact same number of points as Sean Durzi. So Dobson, rough season. I feel like he's somebody that I might still, like, I'm going to have to dig a little deeper in the offseason, but he might be somebody who you can get some value on in next year's draft. If you know, he's still quarterbacking and others have given up, maybe there's a chance he can get his power play production back up to where it was last year. This year, it's been, like, I think the Isles power play has just struggled. They're shooting 11% with Dobson on the ice this year compared to 15% last year, and that 15% number is more likely for a power play. And actually, the Isles power play looks about as dangerous as they did last year. They're just not converting as often. So I'd say Dobson is a good candidate to get back to like 50-55 points next year while quarterbacking a power play, and you might find value from those who have been frustrated with him this year.
Well, especially if, you know, Barzal is back. Like, I think that we're hoping Barzal and Horvat together and like everything changes. Right. And that would be great for Dobson.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's end in Vancouver, okay? So first of all, another defenseman who, you know, was not doing very well, Filip Hronek, after coming in, but maybe he was injured because now he's like shut down for the season. So we don't have to worry about him anymore. We'll talk about him in the offseason about whether he's worth drafting for next year as the second banana behind Quinn Hughes. The guy I want to talk about who also might be good value in drafts next year or maybe still a free agent that you grab now, though maybe not after this hot run, Brock Besser. I feel like all season, we're talking about Beauvillier, Kuzmenko, you know, all these like new guys coming in, getting good roles. Quietly, Brock Besser has gotten back on the top power play lately, like bumping Beauvillier. He's on an incredible run. He's got now 4 goals in his last 5 games and 3 assists. So that's 7 points in his last 5 for those keeping track at home. A couple of those on the power play. Plus, like overall, his stats have gone up. Like he's up to now 53 points in 68 games. That's a 64-point pace. Like, you know, and climbing with this current role. So I don't know what's going to happen next year, but I feel like Besser is showing that he like has the chance to be a home run swing with a late pick, which is I think what you want when you're like late in your draft, like 14th round, 13th round. I think if Besser is still out there, he's someone I'd be interested in because I know a lot of people are worried. Like I know his shots have been down this year overall, but you know, at one point we thought he was a stud. He's studding out right now, so I definitely wanted to bring him up at the very least.
Yeah, good bringing him up. And I don't know what Brock Besser looks like under normal circumstances. There's been so much happening over the last, basically over Besser's career, right? Like he came in, guns blazing. We were super excited. And then since then, he's looked really inconsistent. He's gone like from super cold to super hot, basically for going on 4 years now. And there have been like off ice reasons as to why, and on ice, you know, coaching changes, whatever. But it's funny because it's all averaged out to him still looking basically like a 65-point player, even though he goes through long stretches where he looks like a 50-point player and then other stretches where he looks like an 80 or 80-point, even more than a point-per-game player, which is where he's at now. So I feel like Vancouver has to decide one way or another what exactly their plan is for him in the offseason, and I hope we'll get some clarity on that. There's 2 more years on his current deal where he's being paid $6.7 million. I don't know. We talked about Taylor Hall's $6 million, Ilana. Like I wonder if like Boston could do that straight up with Vancouver.
Why?
Why would Vancouver do it? Why would Vancouver do anything? But that like it seems like a move that a savvy front office could pull off.
Yeah, it's just been a while since Taylor Hall scored 4 goals in 5 games.
Yeah, that's true too. Also, for anybody looking like for other value in Vancouver, you've got Dakota Joshua, who's playing on the top line and had 4 points over 4 games. Nothing against LA yet, after nothing against Calgary, but in an incomplete game against LA tonight, 2 shots already and 5 hits, and against Calgary on Friday, 3 shots and 6 hits. And like I said, on the top line, so maybe Dakota Joshua can help you out a little bit. And Philip DiGiuseppe is on the second line tonight, too. And he already has an assist and 3 shots. There might be some like deep cut value if you're looking to stream in a Canuck. Keep an eye on who's in the top 6, especially in a hits league. Dakota Joshua could be helpful.
Yeah, definitely. No, he's been great for hits, and it's always nice when your hitter could also be on a good line with, you know, so put himself in position to get some points. All right, Brian, this has been a blast. So fun talking to you tonight. Hopefully people have gotten some value. I feel like anyone who's like going to their finals next week, hopefully you already have your plan, but you know, we're here to try to just give you the story of what's been going on, and we hope you enjoyed the show. And thanks to everyone, by the way, for sticking with us all season long. If you're listening now, that means you're like a hardcore fan of Keeping Carlson. I think I've mentioned before, like our numbers are usually like double in terms of downloads at the start of the year versus where they are now. So you're like one of the people who obviously are, you know, wanting to be like totally engulfed in fantasy. And I have a feeling you're the type of person that's going to continue to do well in fantasy because you're sticking with us and listening to our fantasy content, maybe even after your season has ended. So yeah, thank you so much. We really appreciate our listeners. You know, it's I don't know what else to say, but I hope you'll continue listening into next year and also throughout the summer. Like I mentioned before, we've got the summer series. We're going to keep filling up this feed with content that we hope you will enjoy. Of course, another big thank you to the patrons of Keeping Carlson, the lifeblood of what we do, and the community has been so fun over these last couple of weeks, and everyone's been in their fantasy playoffs and, you know, all throughout the season. So yeah, big thanks to the patrons. Right now we're running our promotion where we've told everyone, hey, kick back, change your pledge amount to $1 American, and yeah, we'll give you everything that we have. So yeah, we hope that you'll stick around. Or if you're a patron that just like as soon as you got eliminated left before we even did that, it's okay, come back now.
Yeah,
come back,
play off cool.
We're going to have a lot. So next week, Brian, let's make a pledge right now. The next week, we're going to start like announcing how to sign up for the playoff pool. We got to get behind that. But that's always so much fun. Basically, if you haven't played before, we do a playoff pool where like unlimited people can sign up. It's not like a boring box pool where we just add up the points like we used to do. But instead, we're going to split everyone into leagues of like 8 or 10 people. You know, we'll figure it out once we know how many people signed up, maybe 12. And then you're going to be drafting just for the first round, and that's it, the first round of the NHL playoffs. And then the top 5 or 6, again, like we'll figure out the logistics, but basically you're going to like be fighting to just stay alive. And then depending how you do after the first round, if you survive, you'll go to the second round where we'll jig everyone into new leagues, and we'll draft for the second round, and we do it again for the third and fourth. So it's just a really fun way to play in a playoff pool where you get to do lots of drafts and you don't have to worry so much about teams. It's nice just to be able to pick the players that you think will get a lot of points in this round and not think about like, oh, are the Oilers actually going to make it all the way to the finals or not? That's going to be something for the patrons. But Brian is saying, Elon, let's go wrap it up here. So let's cue the outro music. Brian, go ahead, read us the credits and take us out of here.
All right. This episode of the Keeping Carlson Fantasy Hockey Podcast was presented by Dauber Hockey and powered by our patrons. You can join their ranks and support us for a buck a month. But thank you to those who are super supporters: Adam, Aaron, Ivan, Andrea, Tom, Derek, David, Rob, Ricard, and Patty. We appreciate your support now and all season long. Thank you to Kevin Hebert and our team of co-commissions. In the cupful, kkupfl.com. If you want to check the standings or whatever, we're going to have stuff up there soon for you. We'll talk about pre-registration for season 9. It's coming. Patrons will know first. So if you want to be the first to know, you should. But Elon and I and Kevin are already talking about ways that we know we can make the cupful better and even more fun next year. So stay tuned for all those ideas and join the conversation by becoming a patron too. If you, okay, enough of that. Thank you, Elon.
Yeah, you told me to wrap up when I was talking about that stuff.
Well, I wanted to talk too. GameDayTweets.com for everything you need to know to get through your final weeks of the season. Thank you to BrandonWeeb.com for the logo art, outro music by Pat Roach. This episode was researched with help from Dauber Hockey, Frozen Tools, Dauber Prospects, Natural Stat Trick, Evolving Hockey, Cat Friendly, The Athletic, HockeyGoalies.org, Hockey Reference, Hockey Viz, Hockey Database, Elite Prospects, and Yahoo. Elon, I can afford 2 shots on goal from Quinn Hughes and Mackenzie Weegar before I lose.
Okay, and how much time is left in the game?
1 period.
That seems reasonable. Good luck, Brian.
Thanks.
All right, and while we wait and to see if Brian is going to win his matchup or not, and for all the content coming next week, what should we all do?
Please make sure you do all that you can to help make it so that fantasy hockey can be for everyone.